Tuesday. So if you want to see how council work, you're more than welcome to come. And kind of what I was been reading this book, Story of God and All of Us, it's not a, I wouldn't go by it as the gospel. I mean, I always go by the Bible. It's kind of dramatized. I don't know if anybody's read it, but they dramatize everything. They put words in there that actually the scripture doesn't say. But I know, I got to read on Noah's Ark, the Great Flood. And I can remember when our oldest son, of course, golly, it's been 21 years ago. Our nursery for him before he was born was themed Noah's Ark. You know, we had a Noah's Ark lamp, Noah's Ark toys, Noah's Ark sheets and blankets, and everything Noah's Ark equal. Well, you know, it showed the animals sticking their heads out of the windows with smiles and all this. And it was cute from the nursery. But way of being the truth. And I wanted to read a few little paragraphs out of this book that kind of give a new perspective on Noah's Ark. If I can read it. Lord help me. The rains poured, this is when the flood began. So the rains poured down with unceasing. The waters grew higher as rivers burst up through the earth's surface. Great tidal waves surged across the land. Flash floods wiped away homes, markets, villages. People died by the thousands. The lucky ones were those who could not swim and drown instantly. Those who knew how to stay afloat had time to ponder their fate before the water pulled them under. That was during the time of the flood of Noah's Ark. And this tells about what it was like being on the Ark. And I thought it was very interesting. It says, Noah is suddenly hurled to the floor. He's not a sailor and has only taken this journey. He hears from the below decks the bellows of oxen, the whinnies of horses, the bleeding of sheep, and countless other animals' cries of distress. There are precisely two of each of beast and bird. Try as no might to muck up the stalls daily. The hold of the ark is a foul place with little ventilation. Only a small row of windows on the upper deck of the vessel releases a stench of rotting grain and animal waste. Can you imagine having to deal with that? Because there's no place to go with it, with these animals. And you know you're going to feed them, you're going to have waste. It mixes with the dank humidity of to form a cauldron of foul aromas. Those smells have wafted up through the decks to every room of the ark. The smells have not only seeped into the air that Noah and his family breathed, but into the fabric of their robes, the pores of their skin, and the simple meals they eat. If the storm would end, Noah could hatch and let the fresh breeze in. But the storm seems like it will never end. I can imagine what Noah went through in his faith with God, to see people who mocked him and say, you know, you built an ark for nothing. And I'm sure there's people just made fun of. According to the book, which, you know, this is all not fiction, but fictional, but I'm sure there's people made fun of him. And to see them drown, it had to be horrifying for him. But God seemed fit to wash the earth clean and give us a rainbow, reminding that he'll never do it again. But that's part of history that I just want to share, that I thought was very interesting in the way that the Bible speaks, and that is reality, that we read over the words, but, you know, the Bible leaves out the things, the way people feel and what they saw. So anyway, I guess we'll just end it with prayer. Thank you so much, Lord, for all you've done. You are a wonderful, gracious Heavenly Father. Thank you so much for your family of faith and love, Lord, that you replenish the earth, even though it's worse today as I feel as it was in Noah's day. But, Lord, we still have people that love you and who worship you, Father. Thank you so much, Lord Jesus, for all you've done. You are a wonderful, gracious Heavenly Father. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to take your hymnals and turn to hymn number 271, Standing on the Promises. You feel like you can stand with me. No, let me see it, and we'll be fine. 271.
Standing on the promises of Christ, find me.
these 270 wonderful words of life. 270.
Teach me faith and purity.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good to have everyone in the house of the Lord today. Our guests that are here, we thank you for coming and worshiping with us this morning. Those that are joining us by way of live stream, we welcome you. We're glad that you're here. And we want to join our heart and our voices together in praise today. I do want to mention we have some very first-time guests with us today. The Smith family are here, and we are thankful that they have chosen to worship with us on this Lord's Day. I introduced myself to them. They told me their family name, and I wrote it down. The last time we had a family here whose name was Jones, and good friends of ours, but they came and visited one Sunday, and I called them the Smith family, and I was afraid I would call the Smith family the Joneses today, and so I wrote it down, but we're glad to have them in service with us today. We are mindful of those that cannot be with us today, mindful of those that are facing issues in their lives right now and need the Lord to be with them and to help them through that. Carolyn Prophet, Edward Boy's mother-in-law, fell and broke her hip. Surgery was successful, but she will hopefully be going into the nursing home on tomorrow to begin her rehab. Mark Franks, Randall's son, who had a stroke, continues to improve. We're thankful for that, but still in need of our prayers. Dixie Kane, who is the daughter-in-law of Ken and Jane, begins her treatment for lung cancer tomorrow. We want to be in prayer that God would be with her and that family during this journey. Mike Lowe contacted me, I believe it was Friday. He is going to be going to MD Anderson on Tuesday. They will be doing scans and blood work, and Mike requested that we would say an extra prayer for him, that good reports would come from that. My sister-in-law, Tammy, got her report back on Tuesday, and it was a good report. And the cancer is continuing to shrink, nothing new showing up, and so we thank the Lord for that. Also, Carol Cole texted me yesterday that her great-granddaughter, Emerson, continues to do well, and is back to doing her little happy dance when they talk to her. And so that brought a smile to my face to read that. And so today we're thankful for what the Lord has done, what he is doing, and what he will continue to do as we continue to believe him and to put our cares and our trust in him. I think it's just amazing that the Lord invites us to bring all of our cares and to give it to him because he cares for us. And so each week we are diligent in doing that. I was in prayer this morning and thinking about the state of affairs, not only in our nation, but around the world, and how busy we are, how chaotic things are, and seems to be no end in sight. And I won't say that it was the Lord that spoke to me. I didn't hear any voices, but I just felt this impression that with God, there is no chaos. In the natural world, we have to deal with all of these things, but in the spiritual world, there is perfect order, perfect harmony. Everything's fine. Nothing rattles God. The Bible says He's the same yesterday and today and forever. He is a constant in an ever-changing environment. And that just brought some peace to me, because my hope is not in the things of this world. The Bible teaches us that heaven and earth will pass away, but God's Word will never pass away. And so I choose to put my trust in the Lord. I choose to believe that the Bible is God's Word, that it is true, that every promise can be depended on. And so there was just a peace that came during that prayer today. And I want that peace to permeate every heart. And my message today will sort of go along that line of thought. But there is great peace when we put our hope and our trust in the Lord. And if you have a need today, if you would acknowledge that by an uplifted hand, we'll take our cares to the Lord. Heavenly Father, thank You for the opportunity we have today to be in Your house. Not only to be in Your house, but to be in Your presence. For where we gather together, You promise us to be in our midst. And so, Lord, today we open up our hearts to You. You are welcome in this house today. Lord, we thank You that You are our provider, our protector. Lord, we thank You today that You're our all in all. Lord, I thank You today for every promise given, because every promise given is a promise kept. Lord, today as we entertain Your invitation, we bring all of our cares to You, asking, Lord, that You would minister to each one. Father, I pray especially for those whose names we called out today, those that are beginning treatments, those that are in rehab, those that are awaiting a good report. Father, I pray that You would minister to each one of them. I pray for Mike and Benita Lowe today as they'll be traveling to Texas, that You would give them travel mercies, that You would keep them safe. And Father, I pray that You would extend Your grace and allow a good report. Father, today for every need that was acknowledged by an uplifted hand, we place those all in Your care, asking, Lord, for You to minister according to Your will and according to Your purpose. Now, Father, I pray that You would be with us throughout the remainder of this service, and You would be with Your people wherever they may be gathered today. I pray, Lord, for every minister that will open their mouth to minister Your word. I pray that it would come alive in every heart, and that we would be challenged and encouraged by it. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, would be acceptable in Your sight today. Most of all, we pray, Lord, that You be glorified. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Kelly's going to come for just a few moments and talk to us about VBS. And that is coming up pretty soon. And so, Kelly, come and share what's on your heart today.
I promised David I wouldn't do that in the microphone. So anyway, so it's all aboard for VBS. It starts, we've got about a month. So I know all of us out there aren't really panicking about that, but some of us up here are. It's in a month, and it is Rocky Railway. It's the power of Jesus will pull you through. This train is bound for glory. So we are excited about VBS. We're excited to be able to spread the love of Jesus to the kids in our community. We are teaming up with the Methodist Church to host a community VBS. It's going to be open to everybody and anybody. We have two sessions, an evening session from 5:30 to 8, starting on July 17th and running through July 20th. We have a daytime session that starts on the 18th and runs through the 21st. It starts at 8 and runs through noon. We are in need still of some crew leaders. That's a person that walks around with six or eight children and just makes sure that they find their way and go from place to place. You know, keep them together. Talk to them about Jesus a little. Just show your love in that way. So if you'd be interested in helping out as a crew leader, just see me, let me know, or you can go on. We have a slide that has a web address on it where you can log in, and that's located on our Facebook page, and it's on my Facebook page, on the church's Facebook page. You can go click there and fill out your forms and decide which session you'd like to attend or which session you would like to help at. We have registration forms out on the table. Up here it says evening or daytime or evening, just circle one. And we ask that you give us your t-shirt size if you're going to be a helper or you are planning on attending VBS so that we can give you a helper's t-shirt. These will be the helper's t-shirts this year. So we're excited about that. The church here is going to be hosting a hospitality table out in our parking lot. There are going to be around 120 to 150 helpers, workers at the VBS between the two sessions. And we are going to host a little hospitality table in the morning. It's going to be open from about 7 to 8:15, 8:30. We'll be serving coffee, donuts, baked goods. So this is where you guys come in. If you'd like to help with that, just let me know if you'd like to volunteer there. If you're an awesome baker, you make delicious blueberry muffins. Do you make amazing banana bread? If you could be baking those things, our freezers downstairs in the kitchen are empty. If you'll just wrap it up, stick it in there. And we can start collecting some homemade baked goods for people who will be going out and spreading the love of Jesus through that week. We would appreciate it. I have a volunteer to run the morning hospitality table, but I would love somebody who might want to take over and do the evening hospitality table. I'll be there to help set up. Sheila Ames is also going to be there to help set up, but if we could get another hand or two that could be there at the table and just help us bring it all back in at the close of the day or after it's over, we'd appreciate that. And yeah, just get your form. Let's get as many kids as we can. Even if you don't have kids in your family, take a few forms, pass them out to kids that you see, your neighbor kids. You know, I would just like to have as many kids as possible. They don't just have to be from the Christian church or the Methodist church. This is a community, and we could change our community with the power of God. So, BBS, get on board! I'll take the Sunshine Kids, can follow me out now.
All right, BBS, always an exciting time of the summer, and I have to tell you, we've had a couple of very good VBS sessions here at First Christian Church, but I am very, very excited about partnering with our friends across the street. I wish we had more participation between churches. The Bible teaches us that they will know we are disciples of Jesus if we have love one for another. And that means those that follow Jesus and yet they may not fall under the banner of First Christian Church. We have wonderful brothers and sisters who attend other churches. And, you know, I don't know about you, but I don't want to go to heaven with less brothers and sisters than I have. And so I'm excited to be partnering with them. I think it's going to be a tremendous opportunity for us to not only minister to children, but to also be a witness to our community of what can happen when the people of like faith begin to work side by side. So let's be in prayer for VBS, not only the one that we're participating in, but there are banners around town, other churches that are gearing up for their VBS. And let's be in prayer that God would allow their VBS to be fruitful as they labor for the Lord. If you have your Bibles today, we're going to the book of Isaiah, chapter 43. I believe that one of the most comforting promises in the Bible is found in this book, Isaiah 43 and verse number 2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. I want to minister to you for a few moments this morning on the fourth man. The fourth man. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word today. For in your word there is light and there's life. We choose life today. Lord, I thank you that your word gives us comfort, encouragement, that it challenges us to be more like you each day. And now I pray, Lord, that you would help me to be able to minister those things that you have placed in my heart to share with this wonderful congregation today. Lord, open our hearts and our minds to receive your word today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Isaiah 43:2 is a scripture that we would do well to commit to memory. One that we would be able to recall, especially when we are going through a difficult season of life. And here's the deal. We will all go through times of difficulty. We're going to all go through a season of trial, a time of testing. It's all in God's plan. He will present unto himself a bride that is without spot or wrinkle. And he does that by putting us through times of adversity so that all of the impurities are burned away and we come forth as pure gold. I don't think that I would be amiss today to state that troubling times are here, and that difficult circumstances with the potential to personally affect us are in our future. We know that these difficulties come from different sources. Sometimes it's just life. The difficulty that is part of the friction of normal human existence, and there's nothing that we can do about that. There's just some things that happen, and we have to deal with it. Some of those things can be embarrassing. I waited until I had the opportunity to embarrass myself before I let go of some information that caused my wife's eyebrows to raise, and she said, When were you planning on telling me? And I said, well, I wanted you to hear it at a time when I could tell it on myself. A week ago yesterday, I was out working in my shop, and I have this two-tiered tool chest, and I wanted to move it to a different location, and where I wanted to put the bottom cabinet meant that the top part had to come off. And it's bolted on, and so I decided to unbolt it and do what I needed to do, and Becky was gone. And so I'm out there, and you have to pull the bottom drawers out to be able to reach your arm up underneath to get to those bolts. And so I pulled them out just enough that I could get my arm behind them. And stupid me, I didn't take the tools out of the chest. They're still in there. And a couple of sledgehammers and some heavy tools. And so while I'm trying to get those bolts loosened, the weight of my shoulder caused it to tip forward. And once it tipped forward, it just kept coming. And so a couple of drawers slid out and hit me in my face area, and the rest of it landed on my chest. And so I'm sort of yellow from here to here. And I've been sore all week long. And so, lesson learned, next time I'll take all the tools out. Or I won't put that top shelf back on the lower unit and just be done with all that. But sometimes, you know, it's just life. We don't know what's going to happen from one moment to the next. But sometimes we just have difficulty, and it's just the progression of life. And we just deal with it and we go on. I'm very thankful that the Lord takes care of those that are poor and ignorant. And so I qualify. And I'm thankful that the Lord kept his hand upon me. It could have been worse. Thankfully, I had enough strength to push it up enough to get out from under it. The best thing about it all was Becky came home, and that made everything okay. So it was all right. And so sometimes difficulties come from life. Sometimes our difficulties come from mistakes, and we all make mistakes, don't we? I just told you one of mine. I should have done things differently. And so we all make mistakes, but sometimes we make mistakes that are particularly painful. And sometimes those mistakes come with extended consequences. And then there are those times that the Bible calls afflictions. Times when we are troubled by outward influences beyond our ability to control. We can't escape them. We can't get away from them. And for some around our world, it comes in the form of persecution. For many, it comes through a spirit of oppression. And it's those times when intentionally pain and hardship is inflicted upon us. Well, the challenge in all of those situations is to hopefully come out on the other side unscathed. I mean, that's what we hope for. That's the outcome that we always seek, but that's never a guaranteed outcome, is it? And so we have to face the realities of life, understanding that really we only have two choices. We can either let trials by fire be the defining moment in our destiny so that we live the rest of our lives smelling like smoke. Or we can steadfastly put our trust in God and depend on Him for our keeping or our deliverance. The Bible gives us stories of real life people who faced real life problems. And for a few moments, I want to review a very familiar account that I believe gives us some inspiration when perilous times threaten us. This is a story that if you were raised in church, went to Sunday school, you will be very familiar. Daniel chapter 3 records a narrative about three young Hebrew boys who ended up in a very difficult situation. They were part of the remnant that had been taken captive when Jerusalem was besieged and conquered by the Babylonian Empire. Babylon was ruled by a brutal, powerful, and ambitious king named Nebuchadnezzar, an idolater, a narcissist to the core. And so Nebuchadnezzar erected a gold statue of himself. And he commanded everyone, including all of his key leaders, to bow down and worship it when they heard the music And to thwart any possibility of disobedience, the order came with the threat that anyone who did not submit would be thrown into a fiery furnace. Well, these three guys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, were Jewish boys who had been brought up to fear the Lord. They had been taught to obey the commandments of the law. They knew that the first commandment, "You shall have no other gods before me," meant that they could not bow down to Nebuchadnezzar's image. And the second commandment, not to bow down to graven images, left no question as to the decision that had to be made on their behalf. They understood the folly of worshiping gold while pretending that it was a god. And so when the music played, and others were dutifully obeying, they politely refrained. And guess what? There were tattletales in the crowd. And those tattletales decided that they would rat out these Hebrew boys. And so they went to the king, and I don't know if they were trying to curry a little favor with him, but they said in essence, "Just so you know, we thought that you would like for us to bring this to your attention. Not everyone is bowing down to your image when the orchestra plays." Well, because of his immense ego, that didn't sit well with King Nebuchadnezzar. And when he inquired as to who these upstarts were that would not obey, he was told, well, it's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So he has them brought in before him. And he said, is it true what I'm hearing about you boys? Because I've been told that you're not participating. That you're creating a little stir. Because while everyone else is playing by the rules, you've chosen not to. I can only imagine that conversation. You boys are making me look bad. You know, I didn't spare any expense in putting this shindig together. I've had the finest artisans that have replicated my image. And I have been careful to make sure that this image was made out of the finest gold. And I have assembled the best musicians in all of Babylon. I mean, we've created the Babylonian Philharmonic Orchestra here. These guys are good. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you a second chance. And so, the next time that you hear the music play, you just do your duty like everybody else is doing, and you bow down to my image. Well, let's look at their answer in Daniel 3, verses 16 and 18. O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand. But if not, be it known to you that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. What an answer. This is one of the greatest statements of no compromise in all of the Bible. Let's break down quickly what they said here. Number one, we really don't need to answer you on this because we serve a higher authority. And so there's really nothing to discuss here. You see, our God is the real God. And that means that He can and that He will deliver us from you. Because you're really not as powerful as you think you are. And you really have no idea who you're dealing with. And then they say something interesting. They said, even if God doesn't deliver us, we're not going to bow down to your image. We're not going to pretend that you are a God worthy of our submission. You see, it's up to God whether He wants to deliver us or not. What I find interesting is their safety was not certain. And they acknowledge that. They understood going in that this dilemma might be the very thing that would destroy them. that there was no guarantee they would survive a fiery furnace. Makes me ask myself, would I make the same decision if I knew the consequences of my decision was not going to work out the way I wanted it to work out? Why go down that road if at the end I'm destroyed? Well, because as I said earlier, our hope is not in this world. Our hope is in Christ. Our hope is in the world to come. Behold, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you might be also. That's my hope. My hope is not in the fact that I'm going to live my life and whatever years I am blessed to have. At the end of that, I'm just going to die, they're going to put me in a box, they're going to bury me, and that's going to be the end of it. Oh no, I've got higher hopes than that. I got higher hopes because I believe there's going to be a resurrection day. I believe there's going to be a time when the Lord gathers His elect to Himself, and that we will forever be with the Lord. And so that has to be what the mindset of the Hebrew children were. We don't know if our God will deliver us. We know that He can. We know that He's powerful and that He can do anything. But we don't really know, but He's God and He can do whatever He wants. But we just want you to know we're not playing this silly game. And so we don't need the second chance. We don't need the music to play again because our minds are made up. We are not going to bow. No matter how many chances you give us, our answer is always going to be the same. The Lord our God is one Lord, and Him only will we serve. Well, when they wouldn't go along, Nebuchadnezzar, in his fury, had the furnace heated up 7 times hotter than what it would normally have been. The only thing I can put that down to is just he was mad. I mean, does it matter if you perish at 900 degrees as opposed to 1800? I don't know. Seems to me like either way you're hot. And as Jerry Reed said, when you're hot, you're hot. So he has this furnace heated up 7 times hotter. And in goes Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The Bible says that he had it heated so hot that the soldiers that threw the 3 kids in perished. That's hot. But the Bible says that God protected them to the degree that not even a hair on their head was singed. And neither was the smell of smoke upon them. And while they are in that furnace, King Nebuchadnezzar notices something. And so he turns to the counselors and he said, "Did we not cast 3 men bound into the midst of the fire?" And they answered and said to the king, "True, O king." And he answered, "Look, I see 4 men that are loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the form of the 4th is like the Son of God. Many Bible scholars believe this to be an Old Testament appearance of God in the person of Jesus Christ. There are others that offer that this was just an angel of the Lord that was sent to protect and to deliver Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. What is beyond question is that the Lord, in whatever form, was in the fire. He was there with those Hebrew kids. And I want us to know today that He is with us as we walk through the fiery challenges that come our way in life. He is with us. Cancer diagnosis, He's with us. Fall and break a bone and have to go through surgery and go through rehab, He's there. Whatever the challenge might be, it could be financial, it could be relational, it could be all of those things. It could paint a very dismal picture, but one thing about it is the Lord is ever present. And so here's the takeaway for us this morning. Difficult situations will. Everybody say will. They will come our way. They're guaranteed. None of us will escape. Sooner or later, it's going to be our turn. It may not be as drastic as what someone else is going through at the moment, but it is real to us. It affects us. And so they're going to come our way. They are sure. They're unavoidable. But each one of them provides us with an opportunity to place our trust in the Lord. The second thing that this teaches us is that compromise is never worth it. Because once you compromise a little, it'll never be enough. Never. Even when we're being threatened, obeying God's word is always worth whatever the cost. You know, we're pretty privileged here in the United States. And I know you hear all the rumblings and religious rights that are threatened and all of those things that are talked about and worried about. But today, I didn't have to fight my way to get here. I was able to come to church today just simply because this is what I desired to do. Nobody tried to stop me. Nobody tells me I can't do this. Sadly, around the world, it's not that easy for many. Today, in some countries, followers of Jesus have to meet in secret because their lives are in jeopardy if it's found out. You cannot openly share Christ for fear that government will punish you and in some cases annihilate you. I can't imagine it. I pray that it never happens in America. But I'm telling you, I have a lot of respect for those who say, I am putting my trust in Jesus, and I will worship Him, and I will lift Him up, and I will praise Him no matter what the consequences might be. I will not compromise. The other thing I want us to take away from that this morning is that the Lord is always with us. Whether it is through a literal or a figurative time of trouble, the Lord will not leave us. That's His promise. And when we trust God through our adversities, We can come out on the other side free from the smoky smell of bitterness or resentment or frustration or anger. You see, when we put our trust in the Lord, we come out of our adversities with the sweet fragrance of God's Holy Spirit. It's not always easy. It's certainly not always the most traveled path. But when we trust the Lord, it saves us a lot of heartache. There are situations that we can become embroiled in that will lead us down a path of disunity. It will lead us down a path of destruction. Or we can desire that first and foremost we're going to worship God, that we're going to be true to Him and allow Him to lead us and guide us into all of His truth. I don't have a crystal ball today. I can't look into the future and know what it holds. I can assume. I can give an opinion. In light of biblical prophecy, I could make the case that the path ahead is not going to be smooth. And so I want to leave you with these words of promise today. These are not my words. These are the Lord's words. Psalm 16:11, you will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Oh, in His presence, fullness of joy. I may have things that happen in life that causes me not to be happy. But the fact that I can be in the presence of God brings joy, brings peace. Psalms 145:18, the Lord is near to all who call upon Him, to all who call upon Him in truth. Isaiah 26:3, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you. John 16:33, Jesus said, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Paul, in talking to the Philippians, said, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Hebrews 13:5, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have, for He Himself has said, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. The words of Jesus in Revelation chapter 3, behold, I stand at the door. If any man hear my voice and opens the door, I will come into them and will sup with them, and they with me. Hebrews 4:16, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in our time. Some of the last words of Jesus to His disciples are found in John chapter 14. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. I want us to always remember that the fourth man in the fire is the one who walks with us And he can be trusted to finish the work that he has begun in each of our lives. Amen.
Amen.
Gracious Father, thank you for your promises today. Thank you that we're never alone. In our adversities, in our troubles, in our trials, in our difficulties, you're there. Lord, I pray that when we're tempted to seek other answers, that we refuse, that we totally put our trust in you, knowing that in eternity and in your sovereignty, you know what is best for us. That though our mortal beings could be destroyed, in our spirits we will see you. One day we will kiss your face and we will hear you say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord." Father, we're all going to face tribulation. We're all going to face difficulty and trouble. But Lord, help us today to resolve in our heart, like the three Hebrew children, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, let us make up our minds today that we're going to serve you and only you. And we're going to do that with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Until that day when we are called to be with you forever. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning we will gather at the table of the Lord in communion. If you did not receive a communion packet when you came in today, if you'll raise your hand, one of our ushers will get this to you. We invite everyone to the table of the Lord. Right over here, Edward. Jeannie needs one. Anybody else that needs one? Here at First Christian Church, we do not require that you be a member of our family of faith. We believe that we all come to the table of the Lord at His invitation. This is something that we do every week here at First Christian Church. Gives us the opportunity to spend just a few moments alone with God. A time when we're reminded that we're really not our own, that we were bought with a price, and that price was paid by the blood and body of Jesus Christ. As he sat with supper on the night that he would be betrayed, he took bread. He blessed that bread and broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body which is broken for you." And likewise, he took the cup, he blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and drink ye all of it. This is the new covenant in my blood shed for you." Let's bow our hearts again before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this solemn moment in which we gather around your table. All of us unworthy. Lord, sometimes we can compare ourselves to each other and come away feeling pretty good about ourselves. Sort of like the rich man that went to the temple and prayed, "Lord, I'm so thankful that I'm not like this sinner." But Lord, at your table, we're in your presence. And when we compare ourselves with you, we always fall way short. And yet, in spite of that, you invite us to come. You invite us to taste of your grace. and to understand that your mercies are new each morning. Lord, we are mindful today of your death. We're mindful today of all that you endured, the hardships, the adversity, the difficulty that you endured, that we might have the hope of eternal life. And so, Lord, today it's with thankful hearts that we gather together as a family of believers to honor you, to remember, and to give you thanks. Lord, we're also mindful that within the construct of communion, you leave us a promise. And that promise is that you will come again. And Lord, that is where we place our hope and our trust today. And so, Lord, thank you for this moment with you. Thank you for all of the blessings, all of the provisions of life that we enjoy. And I pray, Lord, that each one of us, in our own way, glorifies you today and gives you the thanks and the praise that you are so deserving of. We love you, Jesus, and we're thankful for you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Larry's going to come and lead us in our closing hymn today. I invite us all to stand and sing along with him.
Target number 101. 101, his name is wonderful.
Again, we want to thank everyone for coming today, being a part of this worship service. I apologize for preaching so long this morning, but I hope you'll take away from what I have shared something that will help you in the weeks and the months ahead. I want to leave you with this scripture out of Numbers chapter 6. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. As we're dismissed, let's pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.